this lecture we're going to talk about physiology of the large intestine. And we're going to start off by discussing the ileocecal valve, the junction between the small and large intestines. I think I did touch upon it briefly in the lecture on the small intestine. Let's just go into a bit more detail here. So the ileocecal valve protrudes into our cecum, and because it protrudes into the cecum, when pressure builds up in the colon, the pressure presses against the protrusion on both sides of the ileocecal valve, and in that sense it then clamps the valve shut. So as long as the cecum is full, the valve is shut, and that prevents reflux. However, peristalsis on the ileal side can temporarily cause a higher pressure on the ileal side, especially if the cecum is empty, and that causes the valve to open and intestinal contents squirt through into the colon. Another reflex that causes the valve to open is gastroileal reflex, and basically what that means is when there's food in the stomach, there is a reflex of opening of the ileocecal valve to allow the intestines to empty out in time to receive the gastric contents. Of the colon. The colon is capable of four basic movements: segmentation movements, also called mixing movements; peristaltic movements that move food contents towards the anus; antiperistaltic movements that move food contents in the opposite direction; and occasional mass action contraction. Okay, so a mixing movement is basically all it is a localized contraction of the colon, localized contraction and relaxation, no movement backwards and forwards. It just mixes up colonic contents and turns it up so that more of it is exposed to the colonic wall, so that water can be absorbed and some electrolytes can be absorbed. Peristaltic, I already mentioned, moves contents towards the rectum. On occasion, there are weak red retrograde peristaltic movements, referred to them as anti-peristaltic movement, and they are thought to increase the transit time of contents through the colon to make sure everything is absorbed, everything that can be absorbed is absorbed. The occasion is a mass action contraction, which is a simultaneous contraction of entire sections of the bowel, forcing material from one part of the large intestine into the other, or into the rectum. So there's a mass action contraction in the ascending colon that pushes it into the transverse colon, or you can have a mass action contraction in the transverse colon to push it into the descending colon, etc., etc. And you get about two or three of these per day. And as with the small intestine, movements are regulated by the basal electrical rhythm. And this rhythm goes about 2 minutes, two waves per minute at the cecum, and about 6 waves per minute at the sigmoid, so we can't have peristaltic contractions faster than that. They're also regulated by our nerve supplies, an intrinsic nerve supply within the colon, an extrinsic nerve supply consisting of the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system, and of course whatever neurotransmitters we have locally. Let's talk about transit time of food that's in the colon. Okay, so once you've eaten something, those residues of the food will reach your cecum in about 4 hours. They'll hit the hepatic flexion about 6 hours, splenic flexion about 9 hours, and the pelvic colon in about 12 hours. And then it sits there and sits there and sits there and sits there. Until really the last bit of water and electrolytes are absorbed from it, and it can take over 72 hours from start eating food before you actually dump it in the toilet because of this sudden slowdown just before it enters the rectum. And in general, after you've eaten a meal, by 9 hours the entire meal will be in your large intestine. Okay, so we've talked about the motility of the colon, let's talk about absorption and secretion in the colon. The colon is pretty good at absorbing sodium ions, and when it absorbs the sodium ions, it changes the osmotic gradient of the colon, so the water ends up following the sodium down the osmotic gradient and into the body. In exchange, potassium and bicarbonate ions are secreted into the colon. The bicarbonate helps to cancel out some of the acidic secretions made by colonic bacteria. And we can even absorb some drugs when we give them as an enema, for example paracetamol or Empapid, Voltaren, Valoid as anti-nausea agent, and some steroids. The water absorption is fairly efficient, so you're given enough of an enema. There's water in most enemas, or if you do colonic irrigation, you may at times cause water intoxication. Okay, so that's stuff that comes out of your ass, the feces. I'm sure you've always wondered what it consists of. It consists of these things, inorganic material. It's calcium, phosphates, etc., etc. Some undigested plant fibers, especially cellulose, bacteria, bits of fat and things that have been derived from fat, such as cholesterol, and water. So although most of the water, a hell of a lot of water is absorbed in the colon, water still manages to make up 75% of the total weight of your feces. Okay, so let's talk about the bacteria that live inside our gut. You can divide into three categories: sickness-causing bacteria or pathogens, health-causing bacteria or symbionts. We are reliant on them for some aspect of our health, and the commensals, which are neither cause sickness nor improve our health. And examples of our colonic bacteria are Escherichia, Enterobacter, Bacteroides, and various species of cocci, like Streptococci. When we are born, our colon is sterile, but as quickly becomes colonized, especially if we are breastfed, and these bacteria synthesize vitamin K, some B vitamins, and some short-chain fatty acids for us, and we are able to absorb these and use them for our own benefit. Vitamin K especially regulates our ability to clot, our blood, newborns, until they have that colonization established, are at risk of vitamin K deficiency caused bleeding. So as a routine thing, babies are given a shot of vitamin K to prevent that window period when they might be at risk of bleeding. Unfortunately, bacteria compete for vitamin C, B12, and choline. Choline is a nutrient which we can't synthesize, but we need it to make acetylcholine. And with bacterial overgrowth syndromes, we can develop deficiencies of these. So bacteria also process bile pigments to change them into stool pigments, and these give our stool that brown color. And in the absence of bile, such as with obstructive jaundice, we don't have bile pigments, we don't have stool pigments, and the stool is in its natural color state, which is a white stool, also known as a colic stool. A without, col without bile. Bacteria also synthesize amines and sulfites, which are responsible for that lovely odor coming out our asses. And then they also synthesize organic acids, which make stools slightly acidic, of a pH between 5 and 7. Potentially, they also synthesize cholesterol, because it has been found that if you decrease gut bacteria through antibiotics, the cholesterol count also drops. So possibly gut bacteria synthesize cholesterol, and that would explain why the cholesterol count drops. But this hasn't been fully proven. Okay, so what would happen to a patient if we removed the colon? Unlike with a small bowel resection, you can tolerate a total colon removal quite well. The main problem is that the small bowel can absorb electrolytes and water. But most of this the work of absorption of sodium and electrolytes and water is done in the colon. So when you remove the colon, you then have to compensate for dietary changes in order to make sure you still maintain hydration and you still maintain your electrolytes. The body does adapt to the removal of the colon, though. These patients with colectomy typically get an ileostomy, so the small intestine comes out through a hole in the abdominal wall, and all the intestinal contents drain into a plastic bag on the abdominal wall. And what's been found with these patients is that initially the food goes through the intestines quite quickly, and you get a very sort of watery and voluminous discharge in the ileostomy bag, but with time the small intestine adapts to the absence of the large intestine, and the contents slowly become thicker and less voluminous over time. And those are my references.